A Ballad of Brothers, brought to you by the terrible Fates. Colin slung his sword over his shoulder, pulled his deep violet cloak around him, raised his hood, and headed out into the storm. The sword's scabbard was adorned with etchings in the azure-stained leather, runes and sigils, symbols of elder magic imbued by his brother to protect him on his adventures. Colin took a deep breath and looked out over the land. There wasn't any more time to rest. His quest was nearly complete, sorrowful as it was. The balding innkeeper took a sealed letter from Colin as he departed, grease stains smeared on his bulging apron, and bid the traveler farewell. He promised to mail the note swiftly and turned back into the warmth of his establishment. The muddy path before the lone soldier stretched out into the rolling hills of the countryside. He had been traveling for some time now since the end of the battle, and though he survived the conflict against the legions of moblins at the border, Colin's entire battalion was slaughtered. Images of the massacre flashed in and out of the wayward soldier's mind, but on he walked, and the rain was bucketing down. His short beard dripped from under his hood, and all through the afternoon he pressed on through the rainstorm. He was soaked through, tired, and still a long way from home. The battle was lost. He hoped to get back to his homeland to inform his king of the failure and warn of the coming onslaught before it was too late. As he trudged onward, Colin remembered his men, brothers in arms, and the songs they sang together around the fire on the eve of battle.
For home, for Hyrule!
They sang, they shouted, they told tales of old heroes and princesses of legend. But it wasn't enough. The following morning, the moblins overran the Hylian forces that Colin joined in the hopes of finding glory. To the young warrior's horror, he found only blood and death. The war against the King of Thieves had been raging along the borders, but soon the war would be at Castletown's gates. Still, Colin pressed on through the storm. As he reached the crest of a hill, the beaten soldier smirked, for there on the horizon he saw the magnificent sight of Hyrule Castle in the distance. He looked over his shoulder from whence he came. Smoke rose from afar. The moblins drew closer every day. Colin grimaced and plodded on. If he stopped now, he would never get home in time to warn his kingdom of the danger. He would never get home in time to warn his brother. Michael awakened early that morning, the sun shining through the clouds overhead. He rubbed his eyes and rolled out of bed and put the kettle on to boil. Some tea will do me good, thought the lone monk. Michael, a reclusive thaumaturge who lived in the forests that bordered the great fields of Hyrule, had settled into a comfortable life as of late. Months ago, his beloved brother had gone off to seek his fortune and do his duty for the kingdom. Michael scoffed at the glory his brother sought, but admired his courage all the same. Since going into his self-imposed exile, Michael studied day and night. The lone wizard spent his days wandering the woods, seeking out ruins and old tomes in order to uncover the hidden power of the land. He was determined to prove the truth of Hyrule's ancient legends that told of a silent hero and the many adventures centered around the salvation of the kingdom's princesses. However, every night, before turning in, Michael would write a letter to his brother, hoping to convince him to return home and leave what he deemed a foolish war. But whenever Michael got a response, it seemed his brother was only more determined to continue the good fight. Today, Michael headed out into the deep woods as usual. He hoisted up his rucksack and tightened it, adjusted his verdant cloak, and picked up his favorite oaken walking stick. After hiking the narrow path from his little cabin for a few hours, soon he found himself at a standing stone in a secluded part of the forest. Michael discovered this forgotten place a few weeks ago. So far, he was able to decipher much of the story hewn into the rock. Courage, wisdom, power. The lone thaumaturge suspected the finding of this stone was the beginning of something that would shape his fate from this point forward. If only his oldest friend and companion would return and help him pursue the mystery of this strange discovery. He hadn't received a letter from his brother stationed at Hyrule's border to fend off invading monsters in over a month. The delay worried Michael, though he sensed his brother held a power that would lead him to safety. All the same, Michael knelt before the standing stone, closed his eyes, and recited a prayer. It was an old poem, a prayer that aimed to summon the triune forces that watched over his world, taught to him by his grandfather years ago. Three dragons watching over us, three goddesses above, along with blessed Hylia, a pantheon of love. Never falter, never fade, for when the Demon King returns, let us find the sacred blade. Colin entered through the gates of Castletown as the storm cleared overhead. The townsfolk bustled about, blissfully unaware of the approaching legions of evil. The hooded soldier shoved his way through the crowds, ignoring the surprised onlookers, many of them not used to the sight of a soldier, let alone a soldier who looked as though he had been to the Dark World and back. Through the towering Great Hall doors of Hyrule Castle burst in Colin.
Your Majesty!
He shouted.
I have made great haste to reach thee in time.
Colin bowed low before his ruler.
What is it, soldier? What happened to you?
The border has been breached. We have failed. He's back. The King of Darkness has been resurrected. Soon, the war we have been fighting to keep Hyrule safe from afar will be upon us.
Within a day, the Moblin armies had overtaken the fields and laid siege to Castletown. It was only a matter of time before the capital fell. Colin helped in mustering the troops, but they were afraid. Never had they encountered a force like this, for the land enjoyed a time of peace and prosperity for the past 1,000 years. The king summoned Colin late one evening, desperate to find a solution to save Hyrule.
Colin, my boy, began the old king. I fear we will lose against the legions of darkness. And unlike the many legends of our homeland, we lack a hero who wields weapons of magic. But perhaps magic is the key to our victory. Do you know of anyone who studies the old ways? Anyone who studies the old legends?
Colin just smirked.
What must I do, my lord?
His Royal Majesty showed the soldier to a secret passageway that led outside the walls of the sprawling capital. He would have to sneak out and head into the invaded lands of Hyrule in order to pursue a thaumaturge that might be able to help. Traveling under the cover of night, Colin soon found the path that led deep into the Ordin Woods. After hiking for some time under the light of the stars and the crescent moon, he reached a modest log cabin in a clearing, smoke rising from the little stone chimney that stood crooked among the trees. As he approached, Michael stepped out onto the doorstep, an open letter in his hand. He smiled and ran to his brother. The two companions were glad to see each other, but soon Colin informed Michael of the danger and the dire situation that had befallen the land. They went inside the cabin, walked past the old mandolin and lute propped up in a corner that used to fill the brothers' youth with hours of bardic joy. In another life, it seems, they wandered around Hyrule as traveling minstrels. Now, their fate had led them in another direction. Colin picked up his old instrument. He turned the mandolin over in his hands and ran his fingers along the strings.
Glad to see you kept this old thing.
I'd never throw out your trusty mando. Let's take our old gear into the forest. I have a feeling swords won't do us much good where we're going.
I'm not leaving my sword behind, but sure. We might get a chance to play for the forest spirits.
You jest, brother, but they're always listening. Michael led Colin into the forest to the location of the ancient standing stone, and though Colin was unimpressed, there was a power there that seemed to resonate all around. The two brothers sat before the old stone and brandished their instruments. They sang the old prayer of their grandfather and breathed in the silence for a time.
What are we doing here, Mike?
Asked Colin impatiently.
The capital is under siege. We have to go. If you have some knowledge that can help the king, let's move it.
Relax, Colin. Just wait. I have a hunch. After some time had passed, the old carvings upon the standing stone seemed to faintly glow. Colin's eyes widened.
What's happening?
I'm not sure, replied Michael. As the light of the carvings glowed brighter, Michael and Colin had to shield their eyes. Then, there was darkness. Total, utter darkness surrounded them. But then, two tall torches ignited before them. The brothers looked around in disbelief. It seemed that whatever happened, the combination of their music and the old prayer reacted with the ancient stone. They had been transported elsewhere. A voice rang out in the dark.
It seems you have met with a terrible fate, said the voice. An old bald man with a long, wispy white beard emerged from the shadows. As he stepped between the firelight, the brothers looked upon the mysterious figure, dressed in a red robe.
Who are you?
Asked Colin. Where are we? Asked Michael, looking around the cave nervously.
You have found yourselves at the threshold of legends. I am simply the man who has come to nudge you on your way. I would have warned you of the dangers of traveling alone, but it appears you have each other.
The old man grinned at the brothers.
Enough of this! Hyrule is in danger!
And when isn't that storied land in danger, in one way or another? Remarked the man. If your home is in need, it appears the land has sent you both here for me to send you on your way.
He eyed the instruments the brothers held, and you may need those where you're going.
If you wish to save your homeland, you must set out across time and space, within dimensions and without. It is as your prayer petitions. You must seek out the legends you have heard all your lives, and find the silent hero who can wield the sacred blade.
The brothers considered the words of the elder who stood before them in the cave.
Let us find the sacred blade, whispered Michael, stroking his beard. Yes, said the old man. For the demon king has indeed returned, and no hero stands to stop him. Which leaves us with you two, a duo of brothers, a wizard and a knight, who have followed a fateful path. Take up your true destiny, boys, as bards. Go, seek out the legends of your homeland, and sing your stories far and wide. Find the hero in your travels, and someday you shall return to Hyrule with the power to defeat the evil that has befallen the land.
Colin and Michael looked at each other in silence. Then Colin looked back at the mysterious old man.
I need to get back to the king. There's no time to lose.
Well, there is only one way out of my cave, lad. But the path is long and filled with shadows. You may be separated from your brother on the way from time to time. But with courage and wisdom, and perhaps someday power, you will find your way home.
Colin looked to the opening, and Michael turned with him. Together, they gazed out the threshold of the cave. A single winding path stretched out into a twilit wood.
Beware, my young friends, said the man. There is a great evil that lurks in the forest between worlds, and he covers his face with many masks. Should you ever find yourselves in need of a bit of magic, let the music guide you, and take this.
The old man handed Michael a large, loosely bound book. He thumbed through the pages.
It's filled with music and poetry, and there's plenty of blank pages as well.
Look, Colin, said Michael. He handed the book to his brother, who quickly stuffed it in his pack.
You carry with you many songs of old, but do not forget to record your own legends along the way. Farewell, young travelers. May you find what you seek.
The two brothers took a deep breath and stepped out of the cave. Michael looked back for a moment, only to notice that the old man had vanished. For a long while, under the light of the stars, the brothers walked this strange path. After exiting the presence of the mysterious old man in his cave, they entered an even more mysterious place. Massive rock formations dotted the landscape until they entered a sparse wood. The trees and flowers seemed to give off an eerie, bluish glow. It was as if this entire realm fed off the cosmos, and the path through these odd woods was all too silent. Colin turned to his brother.
"Well, now what do we do?"
he asked. Michael thought for a moment, then had an idea. "Well, let me see that book the old man gave us. He said we should let the music guide us. So that's just what I intend to do. For now, let's just follow the path." Colin pulled the leather-bound tome from his pack and handed it to Michael. The brothers continued along the dirt path for a while, Colin leading the way while Michael followed a few yards back. The young wizard thumbed through the old book as he walked, flipping through its dusty pages. At the moment, all the two could do was follow the winding trail through this strange realm and hope that it led them towards Hyrule. But soon, Colin noticed a fell chill fall over the land. He sniffed the air and shivered for a moment. Dense fog rolled in from either side as the brothers were coming upon a clearing at the crest of a hill. That's when Colin saw it. A lanky, grotesque beast with slender, razor-like claws glinting in the starlight stepped into view, his visage blocked by the branch of a dead tree. It let out a slow, grating screech like metal being dragged over a field of bones. Colin drew his sword.
"Mike, we're in trouble," said Colin.
Michael looked up from the book and gasped. He tried to form words, but fear of the strange beast overtook him.
"Get back, fiend!"
yelled Colin. But the creature simply cocked its head to the side and walked forward. "Is it wearing a mask?" asked Michael, awestruck and noticing that what he thought was its face was actually a crudely made mask tied hastily around its scabbed head. Colin stepped back, knowing in his heart that this could be it for the both of them. He stood on guard, sword in his right hand, mandolin in his left. Michael panicked for a moment, wondering what to do. Then he remembered the words of the old man. Not able to choose anything, for his knowledge of the tome was limited to what he read on their walk, Michael closed his eyes and flipped the pages wildly. He stuck his finger on a random page and read the notes there before him. "Here goes!" exclaimed the wizard. He sang out the melody, a strange yet familiar tune. It was short and fast, and as he sang, he held up the book, now glowing with an eldritch light. The creature stopped in its tracks and wailed with disgust at the sight of the volume. It shielded its masked face as the light swirled from the pages. Colin ran towards Michael and grabbed hold of his brother, and not a moment too soon. As soon as Michael finished singing the melody, a portal opened and Michael leapt into the swirling tear in space-time. The brothers clung to each other for dear life, screaming as they were wildly whisked away. They were out of danger, for now. When the whirling stopped, the brothers looked around. They stood upon strange yet solid ground, black as pitch. And above them stood a strange metal sign, not unlike the signs that dotted their homeland, pointing to nearby villages and towns. This sign, however, simply said, "Now entering New Haven." With that, the two brothers set off, embracing their destiny to save their home. Two bards in search of lost legends. Two bards lost in time and space. The terrible fates.